Welcome property fans and welcome property hackers. Welcome from Carlo Mariani, founder of the Property Coach, and welcome to these live and interactive questions and answer session on a very important day for all of us. This show is now called 67 Minutes for Mandela Day. So welcome to all of you. Today is very sort of relaxed. It's very kind of free flowing. We are live. It's 67 minutes for Mandela Day. And we're really just talking about property. But, you know, today I am not going to give you a presentation. Okay. So, you know, we have plenty masterclasses for that. Today is all about you coming live, coming on stream, and asking whatever questions you've got for me. So you're getting a piece of me today. You know, today, Mandela Day is just a day of kind of like giving back, is a way of helping, is a way of, is a day of generosity. So let me know that you're online. Just introduce yourself. Hello, my name is Joe and I'm from Johannesburg. And my question to you, Carlo, today is, or the question I've always wanted to ask is whatever question. So, you know, while you're sort of warming up to asking your questions, because if you're not asking questions, all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna love you and leave you, okay? So it's really, don't be shy. You know, it doesn't happen very often. You've got these completely sort of unplugged opportunity to ask whatever questions you've got. You know, it's 67 minutes for Mandela Day. I hope you're having a great Mandela Day so far. My day has been absolutely wonderful so far. And I'm looking forward to this hour and 7 minutes with you. And while you're warming up to the session, and as you can see, we are starting bang on time. I think that I received a few questions via email, and I think that welcome to Madeline, welcome to Tandeka, welcome to Lamlani. Make yourself heard. You know, say what Boxburg is in the house. You know, Madeline from Cape Town, Lamlani, where you from? And you know, just ask me questions. Welcome to Clifford. Great to see some familiar names, and so really just, you know, ask questions. It's really important because I am not presenting anything. You'll see my face, whether it's good or bad, you'll decide. You know, you're just gonna see me today for the next 66 minutes. And so I've received a few questions by email, and thank you to all of those that have send the questions in advance, because you've taken massive action, and that's a kind of massive action. And I'm happy that Neo has taken cognizance of my colleague South African Italian interpretation of a Madiba shirt. I hope you enjoy my version of a Madiba shirt. My 6-year-old, as I was getting into my office to deliver on today's Q&A session, he says, "Papa, I like your shirt." So welcome to Lumlani from Mpumalanga. So the first question I received was from Max. And Max is asking a number of questions. And Max, thank you for asking the questions, and well done for asking those questions. I hope you're online, Max, because those are great questions. If you are online, Max, you know, give us a shout. The first questions that Max is asking is the following. What are the risks that I should watch out for when investing in property? And I mean, I could spend easily about 3 to 4 hours on this specific question. So it's been really difficult for me to kind of like isolate a couple of or three risks that I believe everybody should really, really watch out for. Okay. Thank you, Mary. Happy to know that my interpretation of Madiba's shirt is being appreciated, not just by my son. So risk number one that you gotta watch out for is the title deed, okay? Now, one of the most powerful elements of investing in property is the fact that property is secured by a title deed, okay? Which is effectively proof of ownership, okay? So proof of ownership is a critical fundamental part of element of building wealth, okay? Building wealth. So, and I know that, you know, there are parts of South Africa, especially in a lot of local townships, where, you know, there are significant challenges in actually obtaining a title deed, okay? And I know that some of those properties at face value look very lucrative, okay? The cash flow that you can generate out of those properties is very lucrative. And I know that some people are being lured into doing those investments, even if they have no security of title deed. And to me, you know, one of the messages that I always share, you know, with the community is rule number one, don't lose money. Rule number two, don't forget about rule number one. And I'm absolutely paraphrasing Warren Buffett here. So what is really important is my humble piece of advice to you investors is that if you cannot get security of the title deed, please rather walk away, you know, focus on the fundamental underpin of investing in property, which is a title deed. And I know some agents, some of them are scrupulous, some of them unscrupulous, will tell you that the title deed is with the city council. But that title deed has been with the city council for the last 5 years. And what do you know that is not going to sit with them for another 5 years? Because the backlog, the administrative issues are simply kind of like unbelievable. So Corey, risk number one to watch out for Max certainly is avoid deals where you cannot get certainty of title deed, you cannot get proof of ownership. And that also applies to the so-called tribal land. You know, I think that's another sort of type of investment that I know that some people are basically getting land from the chief and then they are building on the land. But that you don't have, in 100 years, you don't have ownership of that land. And that's really, really critical. So that's the second thing. The third thing, which is happening almost in every type of deal that you're looking at, is property defects, okay? Now, we moved away from the so-called footstool clause, and now we've got many deals that are going through these seller's declaration form. The seller's declaration form, whereby the seller is telling the purchaser what is wrong, if any, with the property, and they're basically warranting that that is the case. There are two fundamental challenges with that. One is that I think a lot of sellers don't understand the seriousness of what that document entails from a legal perspective, and they are actually lying through the teeth by telling us as purchasers that the property is absolutely fine when they know it's not fine. They're working on the basis, by the time you realize that you have been lied to, you're simply gonna be too late for you to actually exercise your rights, or it's going to be too expensive for you to exercise your rights. And as such, we are going to let them off the hook. So that's number one. The second thing is, do not underestimate how many owners of properties simply do not understand what is actually wrong with their property. So let me give an example. they might warrant that the roof is under imperfect conditions because they haven't had a leak, okay? They haven't had a leak. But the reality is that the last time their roof was maintained was 25 years ago, which actually means that there are fundamental flaws to their roof that are going to happen, and they're possibly going to happen, you know, 2 days after you take ownership of that property. That's why it's absolutely critical that you protect yourself with a duly outlined inspection clause in your offer to purchase. Okay, your offer to purchase, irrespective of what the seller's declaration form says or doesn't say, should say that this offer is subject to an acceptable inspection of the property to be conducted within 5 days, 7 days, 10 days from date of acceptance of the offer, okay? So that's really important that you gotta add this clause. It's called a suspensive clause. You gotta add this suspensive clause to protect your right from buying a property that is fundamentally flawed in terms of latent or patent defects. Okay, so hopefully that's question number one. You know, three risks, three pitfalls, three expensive mistakes that you gotta watch out. You gotta watch out for. Okay, so there's a question coming from Tandeka. Is Carlo, how does one deal with a situation where the agent wants you to complete their offer to purchase? Okay. Now, Tandeka, I think that what is really important is that you must never compromise your standards. You must never feel under pressure to do something simply because an agent wants you to do something. And sometimes the deal that you walk away from is much better than the deal that you walk into knowing that you're taking chances. And particularly in this environment, I really urge all of you to avoid taking any chances. Make sure that you protect your rights, right, left, and center. Don't let anybody bully you. Don't let anybody tell you what you're allowed to do, what you're not allowed to do. You know, invest in your education. Know what your rights and your obligations are. What your obligations, you got to know your obligation as much as your rights. And then if you're feeling uncomfortable, next, there's always another deal around the corner, okay? So that's a great question. So let me see, there's a question from Mark. Mark is looking for my next purchase, this time financed. I tried a few bond and transfer calculators and they vary wildly. Are these fees not prescribed? Mark, great question. Interesting, by the way, that you are getting wild fluctuations. Now, I can tell you definitely that the conveyancing fees, because what we got to talk about here, there are three type of costs that you will incur as a purchaser. You potentially incur transfer duties, okay? That's regulated by SARS, and you'll pay duties for any purchase above R1 million. So that's one. You'll pay conveyancing fees, and you will pay bond fees, bond registration fees, because there are two set of lawyers, sometimes even three set of lawyers. But you know, when you buy with a bond, you're definitely going to have a conveyancing attorney, and you're going to have a bond attorney. The bond attorney is inevitably appointed by the bank that is going to extend the loan to you. It's I would say it's impossible for you to make a decision because those banks will have certain bond attorneys on their panels. The conveyancer, though, is, and it's really important, is don't be bullied by sellers or agents tell you that is the right or the divine right of the seller to appoint the conveyancer. This is simply not true. There are no laws in South Africa that give the right to the seller to appoint the conveyancer. What it is simply customary habit. It just happens to be that in most occasions, for many reasons, and I'm not going to dwell on it today, but you are actually going to be the one that is going to pay for the conveyancing fees. And a strategy that works really well is to say, listen, dear seller, dear agent, you want to appoint your own conveyancer. Does that mean that you are going to pay for those fees? Because last time I checked, when I pay for something, I want to be the one that has got the right to choose people that I know, people that I trust, and people that I choose. Okay. So what is next? What is really important for you, Mark, is that all of those fees are negotiable. Let me repeat that again. All of those fees are negotiable, and they've never been as negotiable as in 2020. And it's really important that, you know, one of your critical skills as a successful property investor is about being a skillful negotiator. And being a skillful negotiator entails understanding the position and the circumstances of your counterparty. And in this case, your counterparty is a conveyancer. And Mark, this year we're going to close 2020 with a 50 to 60% drop in volumes, drop in transactions, the number of transfers that are taking place in, they're going to take place in South Africa are going to be 50 to 60% below, which means that conveyancers as well as bond attorneys are hungry for business. They need business because the volume of their business has gone down by 50%. The business is halved, okay? So this is the time for you to say, do you want my business? If you want my business, I want a significant discount against the government gazetted conveyancing fees that are stipulated as a maximum, but then you negotiate down. So Mark, please give me your feedback to let me know if this one is helping you. So the best thing is that always get a quotation in writing by whoever is going to provide you with the conveyancing services. The conveyancing attorney is going to provide those services. Ask them for a quotation in writing and make sure you negotiate before you give them a mandate, because after you give them a mandate, you simply going to be not in the sort of power, not in the power chair anymore when it comes to negotiating. You want to basically negotiate, you know, upfront to say, well, if you cannot give me the discount, then I'll go to somebody else. Okay. So good point about being hungry for business. Great, Mark. So pleased to know always. And a point is always be aware of the circumstances of your counterparty when you negotiate. You cannot just go in and negotiate blindly. You got to prepare yourself for any negotiation. Whether you're negotiating conveyancing fees, whether you're negotiating purchase price, you got to be prepared. If you're not prepared, you're going to be the loser, guaranteed. Okay, so that's guaranteed. And I think that, you know, later on, maybe, you know, I'll give you 5 minutes of summary of four lessons that I think, you know, the life of Mandela brings to us as property investors, and an additional one that I think, you know, everybody that has read about the great man knows that he was always prepared. He was always prepared. He never just rocked up. He was always prepared, and he treated every single engagement in a very, very, serious manner. Okay, great. That was a great question from Mark. Don't be shy, like to all of you property fans, don't be shy. You know, this is a great opportunity to ask as many questions as you want. There's no presentation today. It's a free flowing Q&A. So let me see. There's a question from Madeleine. Madeleine, great to see you online, and you know, great for you to join. So my question is on investing in a block of flats. Would you rather purchase one big building or a couple of smaller buildings. For example, would you rather purchase one building of 60 units or three buildings of 20 units each? Can you explain? Okay. Now, let me give you a principle for all of you, Madeline, and all of you online. Let me give you a principle that will treat you really, really well as a successful property investor throughout your entire career. And that principle is called avoiding the single point of failure. I'm going to repeat that. You must, at all costs, avoid the single point of failure. So, Madeline, I think the critical answer to your question is, if buying a block of flats of 60 units, and then you have some problem, some unforeseen problem, as much as, you know, I help all the students to take out 99% of the risk, you might have bought a block of flats and taken transfer on the 15th of February. And then the world turned on its head. Not your fault. There's nothing that you've done wrong, okay? Not even the great captains of our nations have seen this happening. Now, you've got a situation where your investment has to go through a completely different financial reality. And my question to you is, if that happens, can you sustain your entire portfolio of investments, i.e., if that building falls, if that investment falls, is that fall going to take everything with it? So are you actually concentrating your risk in one investment? If the answer is yes, then I think you'd rather take some time, no matter how sweet the deal is, and rather just basically go for three buildings of 20 units each over a period of time. And because, you know, time flies when you're having fun. And, you know, having started this journey of investing in property in 2003, you know, like it's soon going to be 20 years, and time flies when you're having fun. So avoid the single point of failure. So Madeline, let me know if this is a valuable insight. And if you got more questions, keep putting those questions. So Minky is asking, how do I get in contact with property investors? Minky, what I'd like you to do is to basically unpack your question, because it's a really good question, but I'd like to understand if by property investor, you mean somebody that is simply going to give you money, okay? Or you're looking to connect with other people to sort of invest with, okay? So is this an arm's length relationship? Give me the money, I would provide you with a return, and I'm dealing with the investment. Or if you're looking for business partners in property. So if you can please, Minky, just elaborate on your question so that I give you a more kind of like precise question. Okay. So Kolisa is asking a great question, which is, and welcome to you. Great to have you online. Is what's your philosophy on 20 years versus 30 years bond terms? Okay, great question. And, you know, I think you gotta look at the philosophy of what is the power of investing in property? The biggest power, there are two fundamental, incredible powers that property has, okay? Number one is that it allows ordinary South Africans like you and I to use money that we don't have yet to work for us, okay? So it allows us to tap into money that we don't have to work for us before we have it. And the second one is that when done correctly, property can be extremely, extremely tax efficient, okay? So the concept of property for me, and you know, a key message that I certainly share, you know, with all our sort of members of the community is property is about making money work for you and stop working for money. Because when you work for money, you know, it's very tax inefficient. And we've seen how, you know, like COVID-19 happens and you thought you were doing a great job. You thought your company was super robust. Next thing you know, you're getting a letter of retrenchment because there is no such a thing as job security. So in that context, okay, I want to just create that context. I'm actually quite positive about 30-year bonds as well, okay? I am positive about 30-year bonds as well, because to the extent that you're making money work for you is actually quite good. And remember that, you know, interest on a bond repayment is a tax deductible expense. So I'd rather take R1,000 profit today than a 0% profit today simply because I want to pay down the bond. Because paying down the bond is not going to feed your children, is not going to feed you, okay? But a positive cash flow is going to feed you. So there is for some reason, there's a stigma around 30-year bonds. And I tell you that I am so excited about the day, and I think that day is going to come sooner rather than later, where in South Africa, we are going to get the same products that we're getting overseas. And as some of you know me, some of you don't know me, you know, not only I've got the majority of my portfolio in South Africa, but I'm an investor overseas in the UK, in Italy, in the United States. And there, you know, we are blessed with, you know, so-called interest-only products. So interest-only means you only pay the interest, the capital you never repay. And I know people look at me and says, Carlo, you must be cuckoo. You must have just lost your marble that, you know, where am I going to pay the capital? But you don't live off the capital. You can only live off cash flow. And if your objective is to create financial freedom for you, your first objective should be to create cash flow. Shouldn't be to create wealth. It should be to create cash flow. Once you've created cash flow, then you can build wealth. So great question, powerful question. I could spend a couple of hours just on this one. And Kolisa, please let me know if this is in any way helpful. Please let me know when it's not helpful, okay? You know, my advice is not necessarily always kind of like the type of advice that you would expect. And I love that, because part of my role as a leader and as an educator is to shock you into a different way of thinking about money, into a different way of thinking about property, in a different way to achieve the kind of freedom that you want to achieve. Okay, so Minky is now basically clarified, or she's clarifying some of the earlier on question is property investor to help with funding borrowing money. Okay. Excellent. So Minky, let me just basically give you one. Today we cannot get into the technical details of all this, but the principles are so powerful that they're going to stick with you, okay? So the biggest challenge with many people that want to do property, and the biggest challenge with many people that want to do property but don't necessarily have access to money of their own, or they don't have access to banks' money, because maybe they have done something a little bit sort of like naive in the past, the credit score has been compromised, or maybe they live from irregular income, you know, kind of like commission earners, and it's always been difficult to raise money as a commission earner, now it's even more difficult. The biggest mistake is that people want to borrow money from somebody, okay? And I want to tell you that there are a number of my investment activities, property investment activities, that I do in partnership with people that basically effectively give me the money and then let me invest the money together with me, but they're not really involved, okay? They're not really involved in on a daily basis. They're really expecting a financial return. And I want to tell you that as much as those people give me a lot of money, and sometimes they want to give me more money than I actually want, okay, to be honest, nobody wants to give me money. Nobody wants to give me money. And I never ever approach them on the basis of borrowing money from them. Those people, what they're doing is they are seeking a superior return on investment through me. I'm just a vehicle. I'm a mean. I'm an enabler of what they're really after, which is a superior return on investment for their money. That's really what they're after. So the critical mental shift that I would like you to really work on is stop asking for money. Stop seeking people that are going to give you money. Stop approaching on the basis of borrowing money and start thinking about what superior investment opportunity that is secured by property can you offer to people that have got more money than time. I'm going to repeat that, okay? You got to change your game inside your brain and stop borrowing money in your head and start offering a superior return on the money of other people on an investment that is secured by property. That's a critical thing. So Minky and everybody else, let me know if this is a game changer, because for many of us, for many of you, for many of my students, my members of the Property Hacked Club, you know, this is a game changer. So you should be spending 90% of your time, you know, looking and securing the superior investment opportunities, and 10% of your time finding people that are looking to place that money in a superior investment opportunity. So let me know if this is useful or if this is disappointing, or if you don't understand it, it's okay. We are live, we are interactive. You know, you can always throw a curveball at me, makes it fun, and that's actually powerful and wonderful to have all of you online today. And I know that a lot of you, by the way, I know a lot of you know me, a lot of you here online. I see there are students, members of the Property Hacked Club, graduate masterminders. Wonderful to see all of you coming back for more, because you can never learn less. If maybe you are new to some of my colleague property education and property solution, what you might want to look at doing is to join me on Wednesday 29th, and to join me on Saturday the 1st of August. We have a free masterclass, a powerful one called Raise More Money for Your Property Deals. It's a free live interactive masterclass where I'm going to get into some of the details about raising money. So if you want to reserve your seat, you know, follow the link that I've just put there, and keep on growing your knowledge. So let me see, there's a question from let's get a question from Clifford. Clifford is asking, you know, please share your thoughts on the best exit strategy. How long do you hold the property, and how does one choose between refinancing or selling the asset? Okay. So Clifford, another powerful question, another question that, you know, in one of our mastermind programs, we spend the best part of 2 hours. But I think that, Collie, you know, one piece of advice that I always, always, you know, love to share with everybody, because it's so simple to remember, it's so powerful to and it's so powerful to work on, is start earlier, buy more, sell less. Start earlier, so, which basically means start as early as possible, start now, buy more, sell less, okay? So sell less, it simply means that fundamentally, selling the asset, okay, should be, truly should be, always and only the very, very last resort, you know, in terms of you having to take your journey from A to B. And I must say that, you know, I've had a number of situations in my early days of my career where I sold because I didn't know better. I had certain phase in the later part of my career where I sold and I will still do it again, because sometimes to go from A to B, you gotta go like this, okay? So that's just the only way to do it. So you should just basically see, it should be a last resort. It should absolutely be a last resort. Sometimes it's a last resort, but when I say the last resort, I mean the very, very last resort. Otherwise, you should always think about finding alternative ways to fund your growth. That's really important, okay? So let me just see a question from Lamlani. Lamlani, you're planning to buy your third property. So congratulations, Lamlani, because it just means that you already have two investment properties, which is wonderful. So well done on that one. And you've already beaten the averages, because something in the region of 85% of property investors in South Africa stop at one investment property. And let me tell you why they stop at one investment property. They stop at one investment property because some of them make terrible mistakes on investing on the first property, because they think that you can buy property and you never go wrong. And if there's one thing that I will never tell you, is that you can just buy any property anywhere at any price, you can never go wrong. That is fundamentally flawed. And the only people that are gonna tell you something like that are agents that want to sell your property. And you know, I'm not in the business of selling or marketing properties directly, indirectly. And I see too many people just basically not making money out of their investments in property. So well done on sort of like you've already beated 85% of property investors in South Africa. You're about to get into a league, which is a sort of like 2-3% league of people that have got three or more investment properties. Your question is, you're not sure of how bonds work, because my other property are bought in cash. Please assist, okay? Lamlani, what is really critical here is that buying properties for cash is a slow, very slow strategy, you know, and I don't know your age, you don't have to disclose your age, but even if you were 25, even if you're 25 and you bought a property for cash for R1 million, you still made, respectfully, you still made a mistake, okay? Because you're not making money work for you. And at that point in time, you might as well save into a stupid RA or a stupid unit trust or one of those stupid products that they sell you, because there they expect you to have money, okay? The power of property is that they allow you to invest with money that you don't have. And you're only going to have in 20 years, but you're making them work now. So that's the power. So what is it's really important that you develop your a knowledge and ability how to make money work for you, because that's going to be how you go from the slow lane to the fast lane. And I always say, you know, my sort of like catchphrase is, you know, fast track your property success. And, you know, I don't have the specific circumstances of your reality, but I think that if you're just going to do properties for cash and you're waiting for the cash to restart, too slow, okay? So Let's see. So Porsche is asking. Porsche is asking two questions. So let's see the two questions. Okay. Question number one is, what would be the best strategy between refinancing or selling a property that is situated in a not so growing area? Okay. So Porsche, sometimes, you know, you gotta cut the dead wood. You know, even in sort of like nature, you know, sometimes for a tree to become stronger, you gotta cut some branches. Now, if you are in a situation like you bought at the wrong price in the wrong area, you are currently experiencing a significant shortfall on that property, and you bought into an area where you're unlikely to be experiencing capital growth in the next 5 years, you might as well cut your losses, rebuild your affordability, because now you're getting rid of dead wood, so you can now use your affordability for something a lot better. Okay, so I mean, I often talk about one of my most pathetic mistakes, you know, in my career as a property investor, where, you know, around about 2005, I bought this property in Pietermaritzburg, and I sold it in 2015 for the same price that I bought it for. And it didn't take me 10 years to realize I made a terrible mistake. I think it took me about 3 years, because by then I saw that rent was not going up, prices were not going up, the quality of the construction was shoddy. And really, come 2008, 2009, I should have cut my losses, I should have moved on, and I would have been much better off. So I think that, you know, you gotta look at whether you've done one of those mistakes that is gonna take 20 years to recover. Maybe you're better off taking a loss now, because, you know, I don't know who said so. Sometimes you learn, sometimes you take the tax loss. So maybe you're gonna take a tax loss and then use it. So maybe your mistake is not as big. Don't hang on to mistakes just because you're proud. You know, as a 100% South African, 100% Italian type of guy, I know what pride is. I know that pride can get into the way. So I would say, you know, I don't know the circumstances, but if it's something that you have a shortfall, and in the next 5 years, you don't really expect any meaningful capital growth, try to get out in a kind of rapid, but equally reasonable manner. So let me know, Porsche, if this is helping your thought process, okay? So let me see if there's more questions coming up. Let's see if there are more questions. And I think maybe what I'll do is, while I allow you to ask more questions, we are here, we are live. It's 67 minutes of property Q&A for Mandela Day. And I know some of you have appreciated my interpretation of Madiba shirt. Thank you so much. And I think, you know, before we get back to another series of questions, keep asking questions. We're gonna be online until 7:07, 6 to 7, 7:07. I'm a numbers type of person. As you can see, my choice of time slot wasn't coincidental. I think that I'd like us to reflect just for 5 minutes. I'd like us to reflect for 5 minutes on four very powerful concept that we can apply to our life as property investors as we reflect, you know, on the many legacies of Nelson Mandela. And I think that, you know, I really want you to maybe write down, and Praveen, we are going to get to the pros and cons of rental insurance, okay? We are going to get to the pros and cons of rental insurance. Let's think about these four things. Number one, maybe you might want to write it down. I'm just giving you some points of reflection on a day that cannot just be lived, you know, in its importance without some reflection for all of us as individuals, as property investors. Number one is the power of vision. The power of vision. Now, I often say that, you know, and obviously I'm quoting from the holy book, where there is no vision, the people will perish. And I think that, you know, as we go back to the legacy of Mandela, so important to go back to the power of vision. Nothing would have happened without the power of vision. So you gotta look back and say, you know, beyond the technicalities, beyond the mechanisms, beyond the knowledge, beyond the tools, you know, the collaboration platforms, the teams, what is your property vision? Do you have what Robin Sharma calls a brain tattoo? You know, if I had to ask you now, what is your property vision? Would you be able to sing that property vision without even thinking for a second? And I really want us to reflect on that power of property vision, because property is not going to be a road without bumps. It's not going to be a road where you're not going to have moments of crisis, moments of tears, moments of despair, moments of great joy, and moments of sorrow. That is, you know, if property was easy, everybody would do it. Okay? It's easier, but it's not easy. So number one is the power of vision, as, you know, the four key messages that I've distilled, you know, through some reflection of mine the last couple of days for property investors, you know, for Nelson Mandela Day. That's number one. Number two is the power of resilience. Okay? Again, we wouldn't be here the way we are now. I certainly wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the resilience of the great man. Because the vision was there, but, you know, it's easy to bail out on your vision at the first problem or the second problem or the third problem. So how resilient are you? How resilient are you willing to be in your pursuit of your property vision? That's a reflection. You know, when you have the first tenant that doesn't pay, do you get into panic? You start saying, this property thing is not for me. The first time the toilet breaks, you know, like you say, like, I don't want to do this thing, it's not for me. Let me go back to investing into unit trust retirement annuities so that I can make somebody else wealthy while I remain middle class at best. How resilient are you? And how resilient are you prepared to be? So that's point number two. Point number three is the power of education. You know, I've been quoting, you know, like over the last couple of days, you know, we've all heard that powerful quote from Nelson Mandela to say, education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world. But maybe you can change it a little bit to say, education is the most powerful weapon that you can use to change your world first, okay? Because I think it's really difficult for us to try to empower the rest of the world when we're not functional or we're not in a position to do so. It's a lot easier when you don't have to stress about money to be able to do something good, you know, than when you have to stress about money. Because when you have to stress about money, first and foremost, you gotta get into survival mode. So education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change your world. And I would say, property education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change your property world, okay? Don't be fooled, don't think, and I know a lot of you are not fooled by the fact that there's no such a thing, I'll buy properties and I'll never go wrong, okay? Those people that say so, they've never done property in their life. So that's concept number three. I hope you're making notes, and I'm hoping this one is going deep into your reflection for today. And the fourth and the last one is about generosity. Generosity is the spirit of giving back. In your journey as a property investor, no matter how novice, no matter how much of a beginner you are, there's always somebody that knows a little bit less than you. Please make an effort, to share what you know, the little you know, because the little you know might be an incredible lot to people that know less of you. And by the way, as you educate, you become a better you, you become a property investor, a better property investor. So I think generosity is about, you know, growing our community of property fans, because everybody in South Africa should tap into the power of property, the power that has been taken away from too many of us for too long. But now, just because we have that power, doesn't mean that we should go and do it randomly, or we should do it haphazardly, or we should do it in a way that is so kind of like naive. And the property thoughts is, because I always refer, I couldn't spend an hour with you without talking about the property sources. The property sources are out there looking for you, okay? So this is my only, call it 6 minutes of reflection on my interpretation of the many, many great things of the great man, and four lessons that I think today are talking to me. And I thought I would just share them, and hopefully they're talking to you. Let me know. Let me know in the chat line. I know the questions are plenty, but let me know in the chat line which one of these four powerful, deep messages is talking to you more tonight. Is it the power of vision? Is it the power of resilience? Is it the power of education? Or is it the power of generosity? Let me know. Just give me your feedback, and you know, like we're gonna get into a few more questions as I give myself a little bit of magic water. So great to see Neo. She's like kind of inspired by the concept and the power of vision. Clifford, the power of education. Different things will talk to different people according to your reality, your circumstances. And I think that, you know, the message I want to share with you is not just about the tools, it's not just about the technicalities. You know, Roziba, great to see you being quiet so far. So great to see that for Roziba, you know, the power of resilience, you know, is what talking to Roziba. So and Madeline, the power of generosity, wonderful to see. Dandeka, all four, but mostly the power of resilience. Okay, and that's great to see that, you know, have a reflection in the next few days on some of these concepts. Alfred Mogoru, you know, inspired by the power of vision. So that's wonderful. Mere, also the power of vision. So excellent. So great to see that, you know, I couldn't go any further without addressing Praveen's question, because I think that is the second time he's asking me the question, and he's starting to feel that, you know, I'm not paying attention to him. So let's talk about rental insurance. Okay. Now, there's pros, as you said, Praveen, there's pros and cons, okay? So if you have, you know, earlier on we talked about the avoiding the single point of failure. And it kind of depends on the size, in my view, depends on the size of your portfolio. So if you can, first of all, when it comes to insurance is about a way to mitigate or transfer risk, okay? So let's go about let's talk about the principle around insurance. You want to either transfer or mitigate risk. And the challenge that I see, I would say 95% of private landlords in South Africa, is that their processes, methodologies, systems, disciplines around sourcing quality tenants are shockingly poor. So not you, Praveen, but you know, private landlords are trying to kind of like put a patch on something that is leaking, that shouldn't be leaking to start with, okay? And that's really important, because I am not a user of rental insurance, because in my view, the best insurance you've got is your knowledge. But not just the knowledge, is the applied knowledge of the do's and the don'ts of, number one, sourcing quality tenants, number two, managing tenants throughout the entire life cycle. And when you do that, you will find the rental insurance is either redundant or extremely expensive compared to the true extent of the risk you're trying to mitigate or you're trying to transfer. Okay, so that to me is the critical thing. Remove the fundamental risk of not being paid, or being paid partially, or being paid late, by doing the right things at the right time. Instead of it, like somebody trying to have, you know, I'm not a smoker, so I can just have a sort of like a bit of a swipe at smokers, is like somebody that has been smoking for 20 years and now they trying to sort of like have some honey because their throat is a bit sore. Okay, it's a matter of like too little too late. You're using the wrong sort of like medicine for the wrong problem. So Praveen, I hope this has been valuable to you. And if it's been valuable, let me know. If it hasn't been valuable, let me know. And great to see Portia, still inspired by the power of resilience, who has began having two properties and being a rental experience challenge with tenants. However, you're pressing on. So Portia, you know, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. I'm convinced that, you know, we still have to be kind of like, we're still going to have the next couple of months of very difficult rental collection, but then things are going to stabilize and they're going to improve. So that's definitely important. So property fans, it's 18:56. So we are going to have another 10 minutes of Q&A. And maybe just a reminder, if anybody joined at the later stage, you know, if you're enjoying today and you have you want to sort of like get more knowledge, you know, through some of our free online live and interactive masterclasses, you know, please consider joining us on Wednesday, 29th of July or August, on the 1st of August. It's a Saturday. So it's Wednesday, 6 p.m., Saturday, 11 p.m., for a very powerful, very practical masterclass by the title Raise More Money for Your Property Deals. And you can follow the link on top there if you want to book, or you can follow the link I just put in. I look forward to see you again on those. In that circumstance, I will have a full presentation for you. Today was just like an act of love, 67 minutes of property Q&A on Nelson Mandela Day, and I'm really enjoying it. It's great to see you engage, asking powerful questions, asking insightful questions. So I'm scrolling the chat box to see if there are being sort of like, so Michael is asking, what is the biggest source of below market value properties? So Michael has been struggling to find properties on Gumtree, OLX, junk mail, etc. So Michael, let me ask you a question. How long have you been doing this for? So I want to I want to basically get a feedback from you, Mark. How long have you been doing this for? Not just investing in property, but how long have you used some of these strategies for in terms of finding deals below market value? I'm gonna wait for your answer, Michael, on the chat box while I'm looking at sort of like a couple of other questions coming in. So Duarte is asking one of those questions that I get at least once a day, which means that it's a powerful question and a question that is a hot question for a lot of people. You know, what business structures do you operate to flip properties in your own name or in a PTY company? So Duarte, I'm not gonna get into the details, but you certainly should not try to flip properties in your own name. Okay, that's a disaster strategy, and it's a strategy that at some stage you are gonna get burned. Okay, so you know, this flipping, it's actually something that, you know, we discuss in some of our advanced courses, but don't flip in your name. It's a really risky strategy, and it's a strategy for beginners, and yes, don't do it. Okay, so Praveen is asking, Michael is giving us an answer. So try for 4 months now. So Michael, you've tried long enough. So I expect strategies, you know, to basically come to fruition, you know, over the course of about 3 months. And as we talked about the power of resilience, so you seem to have been resilient. Now I think that you know, I actually don't know the specific circumstances of what you've been struggling. So let me ask you another question, Michael, okay? Great to engage you, chat box. Michael, in the last 3 months, how many written offers to purchase have you presented? So Michael, how many written offers to purchase have you presented in those 4 months where you've been active with those marketing strategies? Duarte, pleasure, absolute pleasure. That's what I'm here for today. Just taking on any questions. And while Michael is going to answer, not to waste any time, any of these precious, you know, last few minutes of these 67 minutes for Mandela Day, Edgar Jaji, great to see you, Edgar. Having invested in sectional title properties, you're thinking of branching to freehold. What should I look for when investing in freehold as opposed to sectional title? And you know what? I think there's lots of merit in evaluating freehold opportunities. And let me tell you why, Edgar, because, you know, the biggest risk is that a lot of sectional titles are going to be financially extremely challenged. And then as a owner of a unit in a sectional title, you're effectively a shareholder of a company called the body corporate. And that really concerns me, that, you know, you potentially getting into a body corporate that is going to have significant financial difficulties. And as a result of that, it's going to have an impact on maintenance, which is going to have an impact on your ability to secure quality tenants. Ultimately, it's going to see a lot of distressed properties. Then it's going to possibly impact on the value of your properties. So yes, you know, you should definitely consider freehold, because freehold removes some of these risks. Okay. So Michael has just given himself the answer why his strategy is not working. Michael, now I know exactly why these things are not working for you. Because, you know, if you haven't written 10 offers to purchase, then simply you're highly unlikely to get the kind of deal below market value that I expect you, with the right knowledge, the right tools, to achieve in this market. So, Michael, your corrective action here is very simple. You need to start writing offers to purchase even at prices that are completely disconnected for what the asking price is. Ignore asking prices, ignore market value, ignore all of that. Define the price that is right for you and write those offers and present them, and then let time be your biggest ally. Okay, so Michael, game changer, start writing those offers to purchase. Nothing is going to happen. Nothing is going to be presented to you on a silver plate. You have to go and dig the gold, and your shovel is a written offer to purchase. Okay, that's a critical thing. So Michael, let me know if that's a different perspective. I guarantee you, Michael, that's going to unlock you. I guarantee that's going to unlock you. So, right. So I think there's one final question from. Let me see if there's any final question. Great to see Tombi is here. An absolute pleasure. So one final question here is from Praveen. How much reserve cash we need to place as an emergency? I think we have been reminded, okay, we've been reminded, you know, through this COVID-19 that you need to have cash reserves. And that is a much better way. So I think first rule number one is have some cash reserves. Okay. Now your cash reserves depend on the type of property. So if you've got the type of property, they should never be empty for longer than a month. Then maybe 3 months is fine. Okay. 3 months cash reserves is fine. But if you've got a commercial property that might take 6 months for you to actually re-tenant, then you might need 9 months of cash reserves. So it depends on the rentability of the properties. And some properties have got very different rentability. If you've been rented out to a corporate client and getting 35,000 rent, you can probably expect that property to be empty for 6 months now. But if you're renting at 6,000 rent, you know, a two bedroom, two bathroom in mid rent, then, you know, you should be able to rent it out very, very quickly, even in these circumstances. Right. So, property fans, time flies when you're having fun. This live property Q&A, 67 minutes, you know, for Mandela Day is coming to an end. And it's been an absolute pleasure to sort of engage you. I think you guys are doing great. I can see the quality of the questions is amazing. I know I've seen some very cool names that, you know, like talk to me, people from the members of the Property Head Dog Club, graduate masterminders, wonderful to have you. And I just want to say, you know, stay safe, you know, stay blessed. And I will see you on Wednesday 29th and or on Saturday the 1st of August. If you want to sort of like do more in terms of your education, please let me know if today was useful. And, you know, share the word. You know, I know like a lot of you know me well. Share the word. You know, let's grow the community. Let's grow the property fans. Let's all just do this together, because we can only help each other. And have a very beautiful rest of your Nelson Mandela Day. I feel very blessed to be here today. So take care, and I will see you soon. Michael, if you want to access advanced classes, you know, you can send me a message to Carlo at thepropertycoach.co.za, and I'm happy to talk to you directly. I'm going to put my email address here, and also join me in one of the master classes. Thank you, Tombi. Thank you, Portia. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Minky. Thank you, Neo. Absolutely great to be here. And I will see you soon. Thank you so much. Ciao from Carlo.